I udsendelsen Stemmen, der blev væk, følger vi Luciano Pavarotti under besøget i København for nylig.
Who is going to count, you or me?
You.
Han er i hvert fald for mig en af de største, ikke kun volumenmæssigt, men altså også stemmemæssigt, som der nogensinde har været. Og så synes jeg, at noget af det mest fascinerende, det er, i modsætning til mange operasanger, som man har set, altså måske især i gamle dage, som jo altså tager indstilling 3 timer før de skal synge en aria, og nu skal vi lige lægge hele sjælen ind i rette folder, så har han altså en umiddelbarhed, når han synger, og man kan se på ham, at han er glad for det, og det smitter sådan af. Jeg synes, man bliver i så godt humør af at høre på ham.
It's good. It's good, the voice.
Is the microphone all right?
Microphone is all right.
It's perfect. It
very good.
Perfect.
Molto
all
bene.
The cameras have started and we have okay. to count until 10. We're not the CNN, so we're not so quick. We have to count to 10.
No problem.
No problem. You're used to counting.
Sure.
Sure.
Who is going to count, you or me?
You. Mr. Pavarotti, you have said I love Verdi, Puccini and Mascagni, but my voice loves Bellini and Donizetti. Could you enlarge on that?
I think a lyric voice, a tenor lyric voice, likes the lyric pieces by instinct. So Donizetti is the most lyric of the writer, of the composer of the 19th century. And so my voice doesn't like Donizetti. In fact, I am doing Elixir of Love, and I am going to do until I am singing. First, because he's the composer, and second, because he's the character different than any other. A little funny. He's a country poet like I probably am, so I like it. Like operatic composer myself, I was born in October, like Verdi, 50 miles away from where Verdi was born. I'm raised more or less in the same way, a little unsophisticated, but with great respect for the music of this composer, for the music generally, and I love this music more than any other, in terms of operatic. In terms of musician, by abstract, or let's say musician in terms of opera and classic, my preferred is Mozart, because he's, I think he's so genial than he's caring, if you consider when he writes the music. And every time I hear this composer, my soul is very happy. I insist very much to do Idomeneo, new production at the Metropolitan, then we brought even in Salzburg with great success. I think this year we are going to do a revival at the Met, even next year.
And you're coming to Copenhagen?
And I'm coming to Copenhagen on the 5th of December to do one. So my voice prefers Donizetti. I prefer Verdi like operatic composer and Mozart like general musician.
And when you say your voice prefers Donizetti, what is...
Feel more comfortable.
What does your voice not like about the Verdi and... Puccini?
No, it's not that he doesn't like Verdi. I think he suits better there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm doing a lot of Verdi, so even in Verdi, I can drive my voice there. But I am using the word drive my voice. In Donizetti, I think my voice is expressing itself wild. If you understand, for example, the On the Horse, my voice in Donizetti is the free horse, then it's jumping without any problem. Verdi, to drive the horse very carefully, to make the jump. The result is sometimes the same, doesn't matter. But for me, the name driving is a little more difficult.
I really had that thought that maybe your great interest for horses is because there is a similarity.
There is a big similarity, big, huge similarity.
Concentration.
For example, a horse is the same for everybody, like an aria. There is somebody who is doing the course fantastic and they arrive first. And somebody else who doesn't do so well arrive fourth, third, second. And the same in the opera. More or less is the same.
And it needs a lot of training.
Constantly, every day. I think I will stop to practice when I stop to sing. The day that I decide I'm stopping to sing, I will stop to practice. Can be, I'm not even sure. Can be, I will practice even after.
Yeah.
My father is 78 and every morning he's vocalizing.
Ah,
he's singing in the for people that they married in the Saturday and Sunday on the church, beautifully. Beautiful, fresh voice till now. Very, very much a live person. I just hope that my voice stop a little earlier than that.
I was at your concert in Hamburg, and I was first of all very surprised that it was such an intimate experience. We were 20,000 people, and your voice was with every one of us. But I also thought, what's it like for you? How much of your voice do you get back, and what's it like to sing?
The real difficult thing in this big arena, you touch the right point, is to have the voice back. So I have monitor in front and monitor on the back. And if I hear my voice, I can give you the most variety of the color of my voice without pushing. And if I don't hear, unfortunately, I will push. So you will hear probably one or two color, and it's not going to be so exciting.
But do you hear it more there than in a concert room, or do you get more back because there is nothing else?
Not really.
Not really.
The same than in a concert room. But it's a great way to hear your voice.
Yes, isn't it?
It is good. Very good.
Do you have to focus differently when you have a microphone?
No, you have to sing exactly the same. That is the difficulty. Then if you don't hear yourself, unfortunately you don't do it.
No.
You have the tendency to push.
Yeah.
But with the system that we have now, I think we are almost perfect there.
These concerts are, in their conception, very modern. It's what young people do, go to this big thing.
Yes, that is the idea.
But opera is, in a way, old-fashioned, isn't it?
I think opera, in terms of music, is old-fashioned, because exactly what we really like is the opera that is old-fashioned. We don't like modern opera. Not my voice, at least, doesn't like it. I go to hear modern opera, but I don't think it's written for my voice. And I'm interested in modern music. In that respect, is an old-fashioned choice. But with this concert, I think it become almost pop music, modern music.
Yeah.
Modern in terms of discover from a kind of new people, young or not young, then they have never heard opera before, and they want to come to the opera after this kind of concert.
But can you describe the fascination of opera, because it's there for people who are there?
Well, the fascination is, in my opinion, generally the presence on the stage of personality. When on the stage you have personality, then they do, then they make you be pay attention when they come in, and they describe something who is, like you say, old-fashioned, sometimes unbelievable, but they begin to involve you with their own way to say the thing. It become magic. So you are transport. When I say personality there, is, I say that because it's very difficult to have personality there. It's much more easy to have personality in the pitch. So you will find a very good conductor then, and fortunately he doesn't have the same stuff up there. And that you assist to a performance. Then you begin to sit down and you begin to judge if the tenor is singing better than the bass, if the bass, and that is good, but it's another aspect of music, then it's not what I like. I would like to sit there and to be involved in what is going to happen on the stage and to forget everything, even sometimes the word and they are stupid, sometimes the, and really believe what is going on there, and that is very difficult. You need big artists to do that. Or somebody who is coming in and he has a state present, then he's saying something very special, different than any other.
That could also...
I think so.
But the music itself...
The music is the same for everybody.
Yes, and it's not always it's a
success.
It's
very well done from the conductor. Generally, we have fantastic conductor in this day, and they make music, so... And fantastic orchestra. Depends from the performance. Depends from the performance from the same orchestra, same conductor, same singers. There is one day that he's starting in one way, and the other day he's starting not so good, and he's ending not so good.
That is the magic of the live performance. If you are, if you have this feeling that everybody is participating at the best, and then you begin with the conductor. When the conductor is playing the symphony, the introduction, you see already which day is going to be. And then the first singer that is singing the first aria, after that everything is going fighting for the best.
And then the audience is
Even the audience, they are part of the of a live performance.
Do you feel the audience?
Oh,
very,
yes.
Very.
You were in Hamburg, for example, and you hear this, for example, this silence between one piece and the other. And when you hear total silence of 20,000 people in the open air, it means they are very attentive to you. They are very looking for. I think it was very, yeah. Very good experience there.
And you don't have to. You don't feel the difference from the person there and the.
As for me, it's just with the music, yeah. And nothing else. Okay. Obviously, I was more concentrated in the second part because it was dark. And the music I am used to do in a dark way, with the light, artificial light, because that is the stage. To be concentrated in the light day, in the daylight, is very, it's more difficult. But still I am used little by little.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure. Thank you. Very pleasure. Grazie.
Un
saluto a tutti.
You're a beautiful young lady.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Yes, she is.
Pavarotti is a superstar, not just an operatic superstar anymore, but a recording superstar. I was right apparently 10 years ago because his recordings selling more and more all the time. His operas are selling more and more, so both audiences are being looked after. And the main reason is not just because of his incredible voice. There was no voice probably in this century, or he's the third one probably, this nature for this lyric tenor. But his personality, it doesn't matter how far you're away, you could be a mile away from him, and his smile will get you. He's like a teddy bear on that stage. And everybody loves him that way. He loves him before he even starts to sing.
And that's not very, that's very rare to find a person that.
Well,
that
makes a superstar. So it is, you could be you could be the greatest singer, you could be the greatest tennis player or piano player. There's something which will make you super, and that is, and I think it's mainly to be more human. He is more human than probably all the stars I ever worked with put together, and the people feel this.
How many concerts have you been doing together now?
Well, this one, this will be the 67th.
How many have you had to cancel?
None.
<Touch wood. laughs>
You shouldn't forget that most of our concerts are indoors. These outside concerts, what we have in here, are very seldom. The first time we started to do it because the demand is so incredible.
Jeg har jo set ham på scenen nu.
Nej, aldrig, og jeg glæder mig selvfølgelig som et lille barn, ikke, fordi den stemning, som nogenlunde, når man har set det på tv, er, altså man kan høre, at det ligefrem bruser og river i folk, ikke? Det må være, det kan ikke være andet end godt.
Det kan jo godt være, at mediebegivenheden i virkeligheden snart er blevet større end den kunstneriske begivenhed.
Ja, det tror jeg ikke er rigtigt. Jeg er fuldstændig overbevist om, at jeg vil få en stor kunstnerisk oplevelse, når jeg kommer derned. Mediebegivenhed eller ej, altså. Men okay, nu er det første gang, ikke? Der er jo altid en kæmpe forskel på at sidde og lytte til et eller andet, som er totalt perfekt, for eksempel på en pladeindspilling eller CD. Og så den stemning, som er, når noget er live, det kan man ikke. Man kan aldrig nogensinde overføre det fuldstændig til en plade. Det vil altid blive sådan lidt teknisk.
Det er jo en københavnerbegivenhed, som alle taler om. Jeg kommer lige fra Bornholm, og også derovre, der taler alle om Pavarotti. Jeg forventer mig fantastisk meget. Jeg håber, han kan leve op til de store forventninger, vi har, for de er sat højt, vil jeg sige.
Har du tænkt på lidt lækkert til efter koncerten?
Ja, det har jeg da. Vi skal hjem og spise efter koncerten. Vi har haft en lang, travl dag, så det vil være meget passende med at køre hjem. Og så skal vi have sådan en rigtig god Pavarotti-laks. Og Pavarotti-laks, det er naturligvis lavet til ære for ham. Og den består af røget laks, skåret i skiver, som så er lagt i en rigtig lækker marinade. Og den marinade, den består af en lille smule olie, altså ganske almindelig salatolie, hvorefter at der presses lidt citron i. Det kunne også være en lille smule lime, hvorefter der så kommer lidt salt og lidt hvid peber, og det rører jeg lige sammen som en færdig marinade. Og så bliver ellers vores lakseskiver lagt ned i laksemarinaden, og der skal den så ligge og hygge sig rigtig køligt, imens vi sidder og hygger os til koncerten.
Yeah. So you put the other kind of chairs, you put anyway, but not here, you know?
Okay.
So you can explain your friends?
Yes.
You have to look here sometimes on this sign.
Ja. Yeah.
Okay, skal kigge på de der, og hvis det er sådan nogle der, så skal køres væk.
Ja,
yeah, det er også det.
Do you have anything in the orchestra tent or something coming up?
It's over there.
It's already up.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, the catering tent.
The two ends will have to come in here. This first row will have close. To lock. You understand? It will have to be close together so it will stop the crowd rushing across. Where do you put the crane will come dead center, right?
Yeah.
Dead center.
Yeah.
Near enough center, right?
Yeah. It's come right.
Yeah. Okay.
As and we then, had in Hamburg,
and you put up the the other speakers in the same way as you had in Hamburg.
Yeah. Right. It's okay. The center closet.
Right.
The only problem what we have at the moment is we have to clear all this because the crane is blocking the exit for everybody there.
Alec, over there. And also the chairs will be the way I asked you.
Yeah.
Very good. Because that way these people will be able to see. But I'm not worried. My main problem is to go. If that caravan, you have to turn around, that will be my one, you turn around.
Yeah.
No, which way you block any entrance for any crowd?
Definitely. We make fences here, around
yes.
here.
Yes.
So that's the only access. The car comes in here, you open the fence,
right.
Block it, and that's end of the story. Now,
Alex, I hope it will be a day like this, but
it's and if it's weather like this, you can also take the roof away, because I think it's not...
No, better not. You leave the roof for all
you can
the
make
time.
The,
because you,
can you make
never
the decision
know when a bit of a wind comes up. Remember how wind came up at the end of the concert in Hamburg?
Hmm?
And he got a chill.
Let's go back to the weather, this outdoor concert.
Please don't mention the weather.
Sorry.
Please don't.
But how do you feel about it? Because, yes.
I say that. In Italy we say that.
We are coming on Wednesday, so we do this.
Please, please, don't do that. I don't know what you want to do.
But as it was raining.
In Hamburg it did rain until 7 o'clock, and the concert was at 8, so we were terrified.
How did that affect you?
How I accept the weather?
How did it affect you?
The second part of the concert I was gargling.
Oh, I saw it live on TV. I thought it was great.
Was good.
But you were feeling...
Yes,
so
a little gargle.
More light the spirit, not so sad. So the beginning, please.
Too much for what is loud at the beginning. It should begin less loud at the beginning and stay. Just at the very last minute, proprio in the last portamento, go to a kind of piano. Possiamo provare
sì,
ancora?
Sì, sì, sì.
It's such a beautiful language. Mai sentito?
Sì, wonderful, yes. So once more, please, the beginning.
Yeah. Il piano, the beginning. The moon.
Thank you. Jeg har aldrig nogensinde været ude for så meget postyr omkring en person. Det gælder jo ikke bare her i huset, det er jo simpelthen hele byen, der står på den anden ende.
Du er ikke selv helt vild med det, har jeg en fornemmelse af.
Nej, det er ikke rigtigt. Jeg synes, altså, nu har jeg hørt ham første gang rigtigt, ikke? Og jeg synes, at han har en helt vidunderlig stemme. Altså, det er utrolig dejligt at spille til. Men jeg kan måske ikke helt følge det postyr, der er omkring det. Det virker lidt voldsomt, synes jeg. Men det er da helt vidunderligt at høre. Man kan virkelig trække vejret. Det.
Han er meget lydhør og hører hele tiden efter, hvad der sker rundt omkring. Og det er også skønt for os, at vi ligesom har solisten med i det.
Ja, under tiden så var det jo næsten sådan, at det var ham, der fik formet det musikalsk.
Det kan man godt sige. Og vi spiller jo også selvfølgelig meget på ham, når han er der, fordi det kan man slet ikke lade være med.
Nu markerede han jo mest i dag. Hvordan tror du, det bliver i morgen, når han giver den hele armen?
Ja, så jeg har prøvet det en gang før, så jeg ved godt, at man sådan ligesom næsten skal tage sig meget sammen for at koncentrere sig om noderne, fordi det er så overvældende det hele.
Vi betragter simpelthen Pavarotti som popstar, og han bliver behandlet som popstar. Ligesom vi var i hælene på Paul McCartney i de dage, eller de timer, han var her kun, ikke? Men vi fulgte ham så godt vi overhovedet kunne, så det er lidt den samme treatment, vi giver Pavarotti, ikke? Fordi vi mener, han er kanon populær, og masser af ekstrabladslæsere skal høre ham i morgen, enten til koncerten, eller på skærmen på Rådhuspladsen, eller i Kongens Have, eller whatever.
Velkommen til Rådhuspladsen i København. Publikum her må nøjes med den næsten ægte vare. Der er transmissionen, der skal igen. Koncerten for velkommen til Rådhuspladsen i København. Okay. Velkommen til Rådhuspladsen i København. Publikum her må nøjes med den næsten ægte vare, da koncerten bliver transmitteret direkte her på den store skærm bag ved mig. Shit, man. En gang til.
Husk på, jeg er en gammel dame, og det bliver jo en oplevelse, som jeg aldrig nogensinde får igen. Jeg har rundet 77.
Jeg er lige havnet her, faktisk, fra Middelfart af. Og vi skulle ind og have en kold øl, og så tænkte om, der sker noget her. Og vi kom så i tanke om, det var ham, manden her. Men han synger jo fortræffeligt godt, så vi fandt ud af, lad os sætte os ned her, og så få lidt kultur, simpelthen.
Der er jo Pavarotti-koncert, Rosenborg Slot, i dag her fra i aften. Og i den anledning har vi oprettet et P-område. Det står ikke for Pavarotti Area, men det står for Prohibited Area, som er 5x5 nautical mile og går til flight level 50, og det er her fra klokken 16.30 til 19.00 UTC. Man må dog radarkurs dirigere luftfartøjerne helt op til områdegrænsen.
Er det noget, man skal forvente, at Rosenborg Stationsplads her vil blive brugt til ofte i fremtiden?
Nej, det skal man nok ikke, fordi det er selvfølgelig lidt svært at trække grænserne. Vi har synes, at det her var et så specielt begivenhed, et så specielt kulturformidlingsprojekt, som vi synes, vi burde gå ind i. Men det er så store afbræk i vores dagligdag, at man kan ikke regne med, at det vil være noget, vi vil gøre meget ofte. Men jeg vil ikke afvise, at det kan gøres igen, men man må ikke tro, at det er noget, man bare kan gøre. Det er alt for besværligt for os, og vi lider alt for mange, har alt for mange problemer med det, må jeg sige.
Du skal selv til koncert i aften.
Det kan du tro, og det glæder jeg mig til. Det bliver en fantastisk oplevelse, og så har vi den fordel, at vejret ser ud til at være utrolig meget med os.
Could I have one of you come over here, please? Please listen to here. everyone around here, please listen to here. I have a very sad announcement to make. Mr. Pavarotti fell sick, and this concert for tonight is cancelled.
Hallo? Mine damer og herrer, jeg er meget ked af fra Danmarks Radio at skulle fortælle jer, at Pavarotti han har lagt sig med 40 i feber, og han kommer ikke i dag.
Og en aflysning. Den stort anlagte koncert i København med den italienske tenor Luciano Pavarotti er aflyst. Koncerten skulle være begyndt kl. 18.30. Pavarotti har pådraget sig en svær strubeinfektion, og koncerten vil heller ikke kunne holdes i morgen. Det er kun anden gang på over 20 år, at Pavarotti har måttet aflyse en koncert.
Jeg har det forfærdeligt. Jeg er dybt, dybt skuffet. Jeg synes, det er en fantastisk oplevelse, vi var i stand til at se her gratis, når vi ikke havde råd til at gå ind og se the real thing.
Jeg tror, vi tager en tur i Tivoli, og så spiser vi derinde. Og så gemmer vi den gode grave, eller den gode laks, til vi kommer hjem. Og den hedder stadigvæk ingen Pavarotti laks.
Og om vejret bliver sådan, når han kommer en gang om et år, ikke? Det, der er næsten ingen af os, der havde tog at håbe på, at det kunne blive så flot. Så. Ja, folk er så skuffede, så det, men det har jo også været sat højt op, ikke? Og forventningerne og Rådhuspladsen. Og jeg kommer nok ikke til at se om nogen steder ude i landet, det regner jeg ikke med. Så jeg tænkte, nu kommer han til mig. Vi skal en dag ud af det med rødvin og stegte kyllinger og det hele i Kongens Have. Og så. Og jeg kan ikke finde dem, jeg skal være sammen med. Jeg er lige derovre.
En vores skovtur skal ikke ødelægges.
Nej. Aldrig nogensinde har der været så mange mennesker i Kongens Have.
De dør vores spids.
Grazie signorita. Come on, Judy, please. To Her Majesty the Queen, to all of the audience that they were there to my concert yesterday, I have to apologize because I was sick. It's something that needed happen. Once, 5 years ago, then I canceled one of these concerts. It happened last night, unfortunately. But we try to come back next year. I will take away 1 week on my holiday, and I will have the pleasure to be here again with you, and you are with me again. I'm sorry to have disappointed you this time. It will never happen, I hope.
Yeah.
Ja, så, man føler, at jorden går under, når der... Altså, jeg selv prøvede det i sidste sæson, og jeg fik noget luftrørskatar. Og man kan roligt sammen... Jeg sammenligner det med en bil, hvor den har tabt al olien, hvis man så kører videre, så sker... Altså, det er selve det at smøre instrumentet. Hvis den der slim kommer ud af funktion, så gør det både ondt og river og flår og skader. Og sådan en mand som Pavarotti, der altså har mere lyd end de fleste andre tenorer, der må det jo især være forfærdeligt, hvis han... Der er ingen tvivl om, at han har været indisponeret.
Talestemmen var en lille smule mærke, en lille smule ro i det, men da jeg prøvede at synge lidt med ham, og det viste sig, at stemmen gik overhovedet ikke i højden. Alle ansatserne, de var fuldstændig væk fra stemmen. Han anede ikke, hvornår stemmen kom, og hvornår den ikke kom. Og i sådan et tilfælde, der er der faktisk intet at gøre.
Hvis man gjorde det alligevel, ville man så ødelægge noget?
Ja, det er jo det, der er det farlige ved det. Der er jo ikke nogen bedre end kunstnere, som regel, hvis de ikke er alt for neurotiske, der ved, hvornår de kan synge, og hvornår de ikke kan synge. Og Pavarotti vidste med sig selv, og vi gav ham jo selvfølgelig ret, vi to lærere, der var, efter vi havde kigget på ham, at han kunne ikke synge på det tidspunkt. Og formentlig heller i en uges tid efter det, på grund af denne svære infektion.
Nu har han jo en koncert i Rotterdam, og på nuværende tidspunkt ved vi vel ikke, om han synger eller ej. Nej. Men er der faremomenter i det for ham, hvis han synger for tidligt?
Hvis han synger for tidligt. Hvis han tillader sig selv at synge for tidligt, men det tror jeg ikke, han gør. Jeg tror, han er så klog en rotte, så stemmen skal retableres, skal i orden, før han overhovedet synger igen. Han ved, hvad det koster. Manden er i 50'erne. Han ved, hvis han slider uforholdsmæssigt meget på en stemme, gør noget uovervejet, ja, så kan det koste ham resten af hans karriere.
Ja, det er jo helt uhyggeligt.
Ja, det er lidt uhyggeligt.
Yes. Mr. Pavarotti is very happy. He recovered completely. He will have the concert here in Rotterdam tonight. And he asked me to let the Danish people know. And all those good people who bought tickets for the concert last week, earlier this week, that the replacement concert is on the 2nd of August, only 11 months away next year. I don't remember the doctor's name, but he was colossal, a throat specialist. And he described the right medication for him, and he kept on treating him afterwards as well. And the treatment was just incredible. It got rid of all that chest inflammation, and it did not, so what we were got afraid, that it will go into the vocal cords, and it would take months to recover. But thanks God, he stopped the infection to attack the vocal cords, and therefore, in about 2 days he started to be able to talk. And right now he thinks that he will be tonight as good as he ever was, and let's hope that it is. That if it is, then it is a triumph for a Danish doctor. So really, it's a magnificent job.